بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. ربي صرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري وحلو لقطة من لساني يفقه قولي. الحمد لله ديان ريسبكت الجماعة وشكر الله سبحانه وتعالى. We have a personality by the name of Sheikh Wahib Abdul Jabbar that is with us today. And just a brief introduction. I know Sheikh probably don't want me to say all of these things, but may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy. May Allah put sabr in his heart inshallah and in my heart. So alhamdulillah, Sheikh Wahib Abdul Jabbar is currently a teacher at IBSA, and Sheikh is also, you know, overseeing the Zawiya, where a lot of adhkar is taking place, programs, etc. And also Sheikh has been very instrumental also in delivering lectures, you know, development and also youth programs also. So alhamdulillah, without further ado, inshallah, I give over to Sheikh Wahib Abdul Jabbar.
اللهم صل وسلم وبارك وكرم على سيدنا محمد الفاتح لما أغلق والخاتم لما سبق ناصر الحق بالحق والهادي إلى صراطك المستقيم صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه حق قدره ومقداره العظيم. نويت التعلم والتعليم والتذكر والتذكير والنفع والانتفاع والإفادة والاستفادة والحث على تمسك بكتاب الله وسنة رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم والدعاء إلى الهدى والدلالة على الخير ابتغاء وجه الله ومرضاته وقربه وثوابه سبحانه وتعالى. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما يقربنا منك برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. وبعد, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. First and foremost, we have to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for this opportunity in which He has favored us in obedience with our beloved Habib sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam, where He has ordered us, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً. And inshallah, with the little that we will try to convey inshallah what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon us, we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open up the hearts, because not every single heart is receptive to receive what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not receptive to receive what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestows upon the individual at that moment, on the tongue of the individual that is delivering at that moment. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to open up the hearts, to purify it, for whatever comes, may it enter the heart immediately insha'Allah ta'ala. And the topic today is very interesting. It is, how do we fall in love with Allah? And I'm sure each and every one of us have our own perception and our own concept of what love is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many of them would say that when you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, prove. Say, قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي. That if you say, if you claim that you love Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you have to follow Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which is a fact. But there are little fine things that you and I need to be cognizant of and take heed of. And when we acknowledge these things, this builds up that building blocks towards that real factor where we say that we're now in love with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And many of these things, we find ourselves, it is generally that revolves around the ni'am of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, around the virtues of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we acknowledge and understand the virtues that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us, this is a mode of finding yourself falling in love with someone. When someone is kind with you, and someone oversees your faults all the time, and someone always puts in place mechanisms in order for you to relieve yourself out of difficulties, how would you reciprocate with this individual? Question. So when these type of paths or mechanisms are set in place, then the way we react and reciprocate with this is that we start to build up a beautiful relationship with the individual, like a husband and wife. And in the same way, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that very figure for your eye, for you and I. Is that He has put and placed so much and so many mechanisms in place that whenever we falter, He has a mode and a means for us to come back. So he says, Jalla wa ala, he says, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّي عَبْدِي بِي فَلْيَذُنُّ مَا شَاءَ. And this is one of the most beautiful ahadith, hadith Qudsi, of our beloved Habib Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَنَا عِنْدَ ظَنِّي عَبْدِي بِي, I am what my servant thinks of me. What he thinks of me, that is what he'll find. If he thinks I'm nasty and I'll never forgive him, then indeed you'll find that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from that. And when you find him and you think about him, he's the most merciful. He's the one that will always oversee my faults. That's why he says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala attributes the abd to himself. He says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِي. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about his slaves. And he attributes his slaves to himself. He says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَتُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. It is enough and sufficient for you and I to contemplate on these little words. That when we think and we see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with us, this is the same Allah that we deal with every single day. No question. Have we asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for a single breath? Have we asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to assist yourself and myself in distributing the food within our bodies when we eat one morsel, a single morsel? Everything goes into its place. Oxygen goes, carbon dioxide goes, the minerals goes. Everything goes into its specific designated place that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wills for it to be. And for this reason, our beloved Habib sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam, he shows us that it is proclaimed by the fuqaha or the jurists. They say that when Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came out of the toilet, out of the hammam, when after relieving himself, what would he say? All known to us. We all know it. غفرانك, is that not so? الحمد لله الذي أذهب عني الأذى وعافاني. And what is the reason for him saying غفران? He's asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. And our fuqaha, who is our jurist, they looked at it and they say there's two reasons for this. The first is that when an individual finds himself in the toilet, it is not permissible for him to indulge in any type of adhkar. And we know that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was constantly, his life, his daily movement, his actions, his breath, every single thing was dhikrullah. That's why when Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha said, Ya Rasulullah, you sleeping? She said, no, my eyes are sleeping, but my heart is awake with dhikrullah. So being in that state, in this place, where it's not permissible for you to indulge in that with the tongue, they say, when he came out, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness for not indulging with his tongue. But the heart was busy. And the second thing is they say that when the reason for him saying غفرانك, oh Allah forgive me, is that it is that acknowledgement at the time of relief that you really perceive and understand when you say أذهب عني الحمد لله الذي أذهب عني الأذى. We thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, removing all that harm and difficulty out of you. Really perceiving this is thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that time when your morsel that you put into your mouth, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala distributed every single morsel into his place. Without you, without your decree, without your assistance, without your help, without you asking. We never did anything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did every single thing for you and I. He provided the food. He made you and gave you the ability to chew. And afforded you to let this food disintegrate in the body. And benefit from it at the same time. And how much shukr and how much thank and how much gratitude have we shown Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for just that. That's why our beloved Habib Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, he says, وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. There are only few people that are really grateful. And when we truly show gratefulness and thanks to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us a different gift. وَقَلِيلٌ مِّنْ عِبَادِيَ الشَّكُورِ. May Allah grant us to be from amongst these little people, inshaAllah. Because there are only few of them that shows true gratitude. He says, لَإِن شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. With this shukr and this gratitude and this thanks, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises. And for this, we see how we make this correlation between how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows that he attributes this abd to himself. He says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِي. My slave, my abd, you are mine. And because you are mine, I will reciprocate and I will give you everything and I'll facilitate everything for you and make everything easy for you. And when we perceive this, when we do perceive this, we start building up that love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So with this, I would like to just throw a few things at us, inshallah, that we could, inshallah, hopefully, Allahu Akbar, hopefully we have pens, we don't have pens. Don't have books, no pens. So if we can remember, inshallah, there are a few places, very, very, very important, that when we really perceive this, it really changes the dynamics of our life. It changes the way our receptiveness with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it changes our way we interact with Allah, it changes the way that we have this yaqeen and this tawakkul ala Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we acknowledge these things. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. All you people, my slaves, whenever you harm yourself, whenever you transgress against yourself, anything occur to yourself, never ever find yourself in a state of despair. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. First one. How much do we falter with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? One of our teachers, beloved teachers, Habib Ali, he said that had it been shown and disclosed to people how much fault you and I falter every single day, then people in the street would walk by us and not greet us. Because they would be in total disgust with the way we interact with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for not disclosing us. And this is the first place where he says that when you find yourself in any state of fault, remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is always there, always, always, always there to facilitate a means for you to eradicate and to remove and to expiate these sins and this bad that we've done. In a beautiful hadith where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala encourages you and I, hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, where our beloved Habib sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَتَبَ الْحَسَنَاتِ عَلَى سَيِّئَاتِ كَتَبَ الْحَسَنَاتِ وَسَيِّئَاتِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has written for you and I good and bad. ثُمَّ بَيَّنَ ذَلِكَ. And he's clarified and made it explicit for you and I, showed us this is wrong and that is right. With this, he encourages us. He says, فَمَنْ هَمَّ بِحَسَنَةٍ. And this is one of the most beautiful things that we need to look at. فَمَنْ هَمَّ بِحَسَنَةٍ فَلَمْ يَعْمَلْهَا. The person who intends to do something good and he does not act upon it, كَتَبَهَا اللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حَسَنَةً وَاحِدًا. He intends to do something good and he does not do it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for this intention alone, writes for him a reward. For not doing it only, he writes a reward for it. وَمَنْ هَمَّ بِحَسَنَةٍ فَيَعْمَلْ بِهَا. And he does it. He intends to do something good and he acts upon that intention that he is intended. What does he get? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives us, وَعِنْدَهُ كَتَبَهَا اللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ عَشَرَ حَسَنَاتٍ إِلَىٰ سَبْعَ مِئَةِ ضِعْفٍ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for this one intention, he's already got a reward for his intention. When he fulfills and acts upon it, he gets 10 rewards. But it doesn't stop there. For this 10 rewards, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you the opportunity. It depends on the maqam or the state of the person, how sincere he was. It depends. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises that 10 from 10 to 700 fold. And this brings us to what? This very time that we find. Each and every one of us want to be millionaires. Is that not so? They say, who wants to be a millionaire? Me? I want to be a millionaire, mashallah. So, our beloved Habib sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam said, outside of Ramadan, he says, Alif Lam Mim. Laysa harf. And we know these things because it's been reminded to us before entering the month of Ramadan, and now people have been speaking, and our ulama and our shuyukh has been speaking about these things and reminding us about these things. And we know that Alifun harf, wa Lamun harf, wa Mimun harf. Every single one of them is a harf. And for each one of them, you get a reward. Ashra hasanat. You get 10 rewards for the Alif, 10 rewards for the Lam, 10 rewards for the Mim. Outside of Ramadan. But that 10 rewards depends on your maqam and your state, how you are with Allah. Ila sab'a mi'ati di'afa. Goes up to 700 fold. That's for reciting Alif Lam Mim alone. Inside Ramadan, everything changes. Rasulullah shows us that a good deed outside and inside has massive difference. A sunnah outside is a sunnah, whereas a sunnah of outside inside of Ramadan gets the equivalence and the rewards of a fard. Sunnah outside inside is a fard. So the sunnah before dhuhr that we made, we've got the reward of a fard for it. And that fard, we had 70-fold. That very fard, it was 70-fold. Plus the jama'ah, 27-fold. Plus the intention, plus the maqam of the person. We know, Allah, Allah, Allah. Allah knows alone. So he says, alif, lam, mim, inside of Ramadan. Alif and harf, times 10. Right? Times what? Times 700. Possible. Or, say, times 70. What do we get? MashaAllah, we get a nice figure. Say 21,000, round about the up 21,000. If we complete one juz, which is equivalent to approximately how many ahruf, I speak under correction, eh? How many ahruf is close to 1,000 ahruf. And if it is close to 1,000 ahruf, then we get close to 100,000 rewards, just for the juz. And if we complete the khatam, which is 6,000 ahruf, approximately there, not 6,000, quite higher than that. Ahruf, if we complete that, we get close to, mashallah, more than 1,000,000 rewards. So alhamdulillah, whoever completes a khatam, inshallah, alhamdulillah, you are a millionaire. More than that, alhamdulillah, trillionaire. Well, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala, make it easy for us to let us benefit. But the problem with that is that we might see and we might perceive these things and understand it now, but the thing is, the problem with us is that we've been veiled with the physicalities, that we do not realize the realities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for us. That's the problem with us. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove these veils of physicalities in order for us to perceive the realities that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has in store for us. And He shows us that the person that made that intention for one good deed, he gets a reward for that good deed if he does not act upon it. When he acts upon it, he gets the reward, he gets the one reward, afwan. And if he acts upon it, he gets the reward of that good deed, 700-fold. And look how beautiful Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us. He says that, وَإِنْ هَمَّ بِسَيِّئَةٍ فَلَمْ يَعْمَلْهَا كَتَبَهَا اللَّهُ عِنْدَهُ حَسَنَةً كَامِلَةً. He intends to do something wrong, bad. He intends to do something wrong or bad, and he does not act upon it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him a reward for that. You get the reward for not acting upon it. With this, look how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reciprocates with this beauty. There we had 700-fold, 10 to 700. Here he says, وَإِنْ هَمَّ بِهَا فَعَمِلَ بِهَا أو عَمِلَهَا. And when he intends to do it and he acts upon that, كَتَبَ اللَّهُ سَيِّئَةً وَاحِدًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala writes only one bad deed for him, for acting upon that bad intention that he done. But he does not stop there. In another hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he shows us that when an abd does something wrong, or when a slave does something wrong with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the malaika, the one that's on the right side, good, and it doesn't have a difference of opinions, either the shoulders or the mouth. مَا يَلْفِدُ مِنْ قَوْلٍ إِلَّا لَدَيْهِ رَقِيبٌ عَتِيدٌ. That no one speaks whatever he speaks, except that the malak is there ready to write down whatever he says. So, on the side, or on the, does not matter, they're on the sides. This one is here and this one is here. So when you do good, he immediately jots it down. Immediately. Without fault. Without waiting also. No split second, immediately. Right? But this guy, when anything is done, this one says, hold on. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, hold on. My abd, la'alla abdi yatub. My abd might just repent and turn back to me. Allahu Akbar. This is your Allah. This is our Allah that we interact with. If we do something good, it's written down. If you don't do something bad, if you do something bad, just hold on, brother, please. Don't write. Wait, my slave might just repent at this moment. He might just repent. And if he repents, you don't write it down. If he repents, he's going to get rewards for the repentance also. And look how beautiful is this repentance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks in this beautiful narration of Imam Ghazali, hafidhahullah wa radiyallahu ta'ala an, in his book of Tawbah in Ihya. He says that there was a slave girl in a town, that this slave girl used to move around in town for this man, for this individual, because she was owned by someone. And there was a youngster, a lad, who fell in love with her. And due to him being free and she being a slave of someone else, he could not possess her. She's property of someone else. And this love or this attraction increased and increased and increased so much so that a time came that he felt the urge that he needed to approach her. And at this very moment, he found out that the slave master of the woman had a mission for this girl and to send her out of town. And he thought, this is perfect opportunity for me. Perfect opportunity. And when he sent her out of town, he followed her. فَتَرَقَّبَ عَلَيْهَا. He walked behind her. And when he came, they came to a resting place in scorching heat, hot day. Scorching heat, she sat down and she saw him approaching. And when he approached, he came with that intention, and we know, if you have intentions, it's shown in the eye. The eyes display a lot. The face displays a lot. So it is shown in his eyes, and she looks at him, she says, Ittaqillah. Fear Allah. For my inclination and my desire for you is greater than what you think your desire is for me. But I fear Allah. And with this, it strikes him. Not everyone, like we said, not every heart is receptive to specific words. This affected him immediately. In the same way that, look, when an old lady approached Sayyidina Umar radiallahu ta'ala, and when Umar, لو كان نبيا بعد رسول الله كان عمر, if there was a Nabi, a prophet of that high esteem after Rasulullah, it would have been him, Umar radiallahu ta'ala. Him, Umar, an old lady says to him, Ittaqillah. He started weeping. How can you tell me to fear God? That's my life. That's the every single atom in my body fears Allah. And it broke him down. And in the same way, it affected this youngster. When it affected him, he felt remorse. He felt pain in his heart. He turned around and he repented to Allah. For this, at this moment, he met this is from the Israeliyat, he met a messenger of the prophet of that time. And when the messenger saw him walking on his path, he said to him, my brother, hold on. Don't you want to walk with me, a company, nice company? And when he said, yes, no problem, we walked together, and they came, they walked together. I asked him, what's your story? He says, no, I just traveled, I'm a sinner, and so forth. So he looked at him and he said, they relaxed, sat by a tree or calmed down by a place where there's a little shade. And he said, you know what? Let's ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I make dua. I mean, you make dua and I say ameen. So this person said, the sinner, he says, it's impossible for me to make dua to Allah. Because I am a sinner and everything that I've done in this entire journey is in disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this messenger looked at him and says, no problem. I will make dua and you say ameen. I make dua, you say ameen. And he made dua. Oh Allah, grant us the cloud that will cover us and give us shade for our entire journey wherever we're going to go. And he says ameen. And with this ameen, immediately a cloud came to cover them. And they walked until they came to the point where they needed to part their ways. And as they part, this is Assalamu alaikum, see you fine, bye. When they part their ways, we know. It's kind of logical. What happens? The cloud follows who? The messenger or the sinner? No, the cloud follows the sinner. And with this, the messenger questions, how is this possible? You said you were a sinner. And he knows, he's a messenger of a prophet of that time. He said, you're a sinner. Come here, hold on. What is your deal? And he explained to him every single thing. And with this, he looked at him and he smiled. He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has accepted your tawbah and grant you from zero to hero. Just you and I sitting at this very moment in this time, it just takes a pure, sincere intention to change. And with a bolt of lightning, as quick as that. Not a bolt of lightning, inshallah. Allah, don't strike us with a bolt of lightning. And I mean, as quick as that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can change your state and ours, my state, in that very, very moment, from absolutely nothing, a disobedient slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to everything that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants that's pleasing to Him. That's why it shows us the importance of the heart of the abd. It brings us to this, to show us that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reciprocates with you and I. So that's the first one. The second, which is acknowledging that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is ni'am and tawbah. The second thing is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, every single night, as the hadith says, he says, Inna Allah, in different narrations, Inna Allah yanzilu fi akhir al-layl. But we know that this metaphorically speaking. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not move. There's no time, no space for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, no direction. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in another narration, says where Rasulullah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends down a malak to the first heaven. And every single evening he calls out. He calls out. He says, Ya hal min mustaghfirin, hal min ta'ibin, hal min dhi haja, Allah. These words are not words of your friend. These words are not words of me. It's not words of Rasulullah also. These words are words of Allah. And He's asking you and I at that very moment where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raises these veils between you and I and asks you, is there anything that you want to repent for? Let me repent. Is there anything that you want me to forgive you? Let me forgive you. Is there any need and any desire and anything that you require in this life? Let me give it to you and let me facilitate it for you. At that very moment, before Fajr. And alhamdulillah, all of us are up before Fajr, now in Ramadan. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it so that we stay up every single day throughout our entire life, inshallah, before Fajr. And to grant us to be from amongst these people. So, in another narration of the Israeliyat, just to show how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mercy upon you and I. Before, Allahu Akbar, how much time do we have left? No, we need to stick to time. How much time? Okay, I mentioned one thing, then just a few points inshallah, because we never got to the point yet. Please forgive me. This hadith is a hadith of the Israeliyat, in the books, previous books. And this was quoted and narrated to us by our beloved teacher, Habib Ali. And he says that in that time, still, جَاءَ الْبَحَرُ يَسْتَأْذِنُ اللَّهَ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى صَبِيحَةَ كُلَّ يَوْمٍ, that the sea comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in request every single morning. Comes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Ya Rab, give me the permission an yaghriq kulla nas al-usat. Give me the permission to drown every single individual that is disobedient to you on this, that's on the face of my, on the face of the water. And in the same way the samawat comes, it says, Ya Allah, give us permission to close up the sama, or to drop everyone out of the sama that is disobedient to you. And the earth is the same. He says, Ya Allah, asking you permission, Oh Allah, give us permission to open up and swallow all those people who are disobedient to you so that we can take them off from this earth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala responds, فَيَقُولُ اللَّهُ سُبْحَانَهُ وَتَعَالَى لِلْبَحْرِ وَلِلْسَّمَاءِ وَلِلْأَرْضِ. You have to, Allahu Akbar. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses and he says, وَلِلْسَّمَاءِ وَلِلْأَرْضِ وَلِلْبَحْرِ, he says, إِنَّكُمْ لَمْ تَخْلُكُوهُ, إِنَّكُمْ لَمْ تَخْلُكُوهُ وَلَوْ خَلَقْتُمُوهُ لَمَا قُلْتُمْ هَذَا. You have not created them. If you had created them, you would never ask me what you're asking me now. Do we understand it? The mom, I make another example. The mother, when Rasulullah ﷺ was sitting, one of the battles, and the woman was running ballistic, and she was going up, down, looking for a little son, a child. And after a while, she finds a child. And as they find one another, they're running, stumbling towards each other, kissing one another and crying. And the companions of Rasulullah ﷺ sitting, and they started crying and weeping. And Rasulullah looks at them and says, Ma bikum, ma yubkikum. What's wrong with you guys? Why are you crying? He says, Ya Rasulullah, ama tarawun hadhi al-mandar? Do you not see this? Do you not see this? The compassion, the love that this mother has for this child. And this is the time of rahmah. We're in the first 10 days, the time of rahmah. For us to, you know, just to wake up a little. So he says, Allah, Rasulullah uses this opportunity to teach you and I. And he says what? He says, أَتَرَوْنَ هَذِي الْمَرْأَى مُلْقِيَةً وَلَدَهَا فِي النَّارِ. Do you see this mother throwing, is it possible? Do you see this mother throwing her son or her child into the fire? They say no. They say, no, it's impossible for a mother. And we know this is the mother sitting. Is it possible for you to throw your son, your daughter, into the fire? It's impossible. Irrespective of what they've done. They might have been disobedient to you throughout the entire life. You'll never give up on them. That's how a mother is. Is that not so, moms? So Rasulullah says, Inna Allaha yuhibbukum, or Inna Allaha hab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you more than that mother loves that very child. That's why He has facilitated for you and I. Every time we step out of line, He has made it a way for us and facilitated a way for us. So let me just throw out a few things out because I know time is running up. Walana never gave us time. Walana Marwan? He never gave us time. Give us time, inshallah. So let us throw a few points out, inshallah. Bismillah. The first one I would like to bring to our attention is that there's a beautiful hadith that mentions where Rasulullah, or the beautiful hadith, a narration from the Salihin radiallahu ta'ala anhum, that they quote this and they say, Man qala, the person who says, every single morning, or every single evening, or every morning and evening, right? Astaghfirullah alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-hayyu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayhi, Rabbi ghfirli. The person who says, Astaghfirullah alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-rahman, Astaghfirullah alladhi la ilaha illa huwa al-rahman al-rahim al-hayyu al-qayyum wa atubu ilayhi, Rabbi ghfirli. أستغفر الله الذي لا إله إلا هو الرحمن الرحيم الحي القيوم وأتوب إليه ربك في لي 25 times. And this is a custom that we find in Hadramaut. Every single morning we're reading this, and we never knew, because we're students. Alhamdulillah, we're still students. But we're students and we're doing this adhkar, and we just read it, and you never know what you're doing. Until you come across the narration sometimes, and you're just blown away by why this beautiful adhkar is compiled by our salihin. And it says in the book of Tafrijul Qulub, and he says that the person who recites this very dhikr every single morning 25 times, or every single evening 25 times, or every single morning and evening 25 times, meaning daily 25 times, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will afford it so that this person will not see anything that he dislikes around him, nor in his community, nor in his household, inshallah. One. Second one, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us just before this time, before Dhuhr, he taught us in a beautiful hadith. He said that the person that performs four raka'ah, and we need to be really greedy. In the month of Ramadan, you have to exert yourself. You have to push yourself, maximize. I say why quickly, is that our lifestyle on that side of the world is a little different to this. So alhamdulillah, so we don't have work on that side. Their work occurs in the evening. Day and night is flipped around for Ramadan. Day and night flipped around. So everything that occurs in the day, it's in the night from Maghrib, from Isha, right up until Fajr, shops are open. From after the sun has risen, shops go close. Right up until Dhuhr, opposite effect. So from that time till that time is sleeping time. From sunrise till Dhuhr is sleeping time. But the evenings, everyone is up. And we have adhkar, and we have lessons, and we have, it's just a whole lot of bunch of a'mal that is being done. In fact, they will have a tarawih, 10 o'clock in this masjid, tarawih, 11 o'clock in this masjid, 12 o'clock in that masjid, 1 o'clock in that masjid, 2 o'clock there, and 3 o'clock there. And some people, if they want to push themselves, to exert themselves, they go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Like 100 raka'ah a night. 100 raka'ah is 100 raka'ah of fard rewards. That's why tarawih, we shouldn't take it lightly. That tarawih is fard outside of Ramadan. That tarawih is the rewards of a fard outside of Ramadan. So, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the person who performs four raka'ah before Dhuhr, the time of Dhuhr, after the sun has moved off from his pivot, or from the summit, when the sun has passed by, which is just past 12 o'clock, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, futtihat, أو فتحت أبواب السماء. That the heavens open. He says, وأن وأحب أن أعمل صالحا في هذا الوقت. And I love to act any good deed, meaning that I would perform salah specific four raka'ah straight with no taslim. Taslim at the end. Four raka'ah straight so that I will receive the barakah of that time. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala opens up the heavens, the sama, at that very moment. When you and I perform salah, inna salata tanha anil fahshai wal munkar, is that not so? Supposed to be. Inna salata tanha anil fahshai wal munkar. That salah eradicates and removes every bad out of our life. And there's no way that you can step out of line if you perform your salah correct, adequate, properly, in accordance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you and I to do it. And for this, Rasulullah shows us that when you say Allahu Akbar, we know that we are going into the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You and I, we know that. فَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَى فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاك. If you do not acknowledge, if you cannot see Him Jalla wa'ala, if you cannot see Him, then note and know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is observing over you. So stand in the mode, in a way that knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is observing me standing in front of you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam shows us that when you say Allahu Akbar, one day you're standing with his companions, and they said Allahu Akbar, and one of the guys said behind, he says, Allahu Akbar kabira, alhamdulillah kathira, subhanallah bukrata wa asila. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam completed salah. He turned around. He says, Ain al-Qa'il. Where's this person that said that? You know, they're a little afraid because why? They don't know, is Rasulullah going to reprimand me or he's going to give me glad tidings? He said, me, ya Rasulullah, ana. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, ajibtu. He said, ajibtu, that I was amazed by these words that you said. It astounded me. It just blew me away. What he said? He says, when I heard these words, I saw the heavens opening up. What does that mean? It means that your du'as and everything that you're doing is direct. You've just opened up the path for yourself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So when we are cognizant of these little things, it changes the dynamics of our being. Every single atom within ourselves changes. And at that moment when you say, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Hamidani Abdi. Look how He's praising me. Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim Majjadani Abdi. Look how He's in awe, total honor of me. Maliki Yawm Al-Din. Allah subhanahu says, Hada Baini Wa Bain Abdi. This is between me and my Abd. He's acknowledging Maliki Yawm Al-Din. Ihdina الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم. When you say that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this at this point is between me and my slave. What he asks, he gets. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. What more do we want? اهدنا الصراط. Ya Allah, اهدنا الصراط المستقيم. Say Amin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide us on the right path. And when he ends up, غير المغضوب اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين ولعبدي ما سأل. And let him ask whatever he wants and I'm going to give it to him. You've just opened up the doors of the heaven. And now you're asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do you think nothing is going there? ادعوا الله وأنتم موقنون بالعجاب بالإجابة. Call upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give you. And in this way we will find a transformation. When we acknowledge these things, we will find transformation. Allahu Akbar. Going to ruku. Listen to this. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with some of his companions, and this companion goes into ruku, and as they come out, he says, سَمِعَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ حَمِدَ رَبَّنَا لَكَ الْحَمْدُ حَمْدًا كَثِيرًا طَيِّبًا مُبَارَكًا فِيهِ مِلْأَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمِلْأَ مَا. He says this, مِلْأَ مَا بَيْنَهُمَا مِلْأَ مَا شِئْتَ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after salah again, he turns around and says, where is this guy that said that? Ya Allah, me Rasulullah. Rasulullah said, I saw more than such and such 30. I saw more than such and such amount of malaika hastening to write down these words that you've just said now. I saw them rushing. You just said, hamdan kathiran tayyiban mubarak. I saw them all rushing towards to write down these rewards because they knew that this reward is much in front of the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Where are you and I? That's why الطلب العلم فريضة على كل مسلم. It is necessary for us to seek. And with this, believe me, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, this gathering is most beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This gathering is mubarak to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let me tell you a favor, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala favors us with these gatherings. Look what him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says with these type of gatherings. Because first of all, it's in the masjid. لا يستمع قوم من أن يذكر الله. There is no people that gather in the house of Allah except to remember Allah. Same. In the house of Allah, remember Allah. Two things. Three, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, those people that said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَكَّلَ نَادَى مُنَادٍ مِّنَ السَّمَاءِ أَنْ قُومُوا مَغْفُورًا لَكُمْ. That a malak calls out from the heavens, أَنْ قُومُوا مَغْفُورًا لَكُمْ. When you stand up, you are forgiven from all your sins. لَقَدْ بُدِّلَتْ سَيِّئَاتِكُمُ الْحَسَنَاتِ. This is this Allah that we are dealing with every single day. We, in our own way, so much wrong that we are dealing with this Allah like that. And he says, just for sitting here, that when you leave this gathering, I have replaced, not just forgiven all your bad, I've replaced it with good. Allahu Akbar. It is enough for us. وَكَفَى بِهِ. It is enough for us, this Allah. حَسْبُنَ اللَّهُ وَنِعْمَ الْوَكِيلُ. Allah is enough for us. I think it was end of the inshallah. I think we should end of the inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, really, to remove the veils of our eyes. So that we, and remove the veils of our hearts. So that we may perceive the realities and the gifts that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala dress and bless the hearts of the awliya. Because these are the hearts that has received and perceived and see Allah. Not see, this one, see here. See with the heart. And that is called true ma'rifah in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us this insha'Allah ta'ala. Subhanak Allahumma wa hamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, nastaghfir. ليتك دوما